Pinagagalo ko po kilala, oops, na kinagagalo kong makasama sa inyo. So much for that. So if I have to coordinate two things here. So the vision of this preliminary paper that I'm going to be talking about is what would happen if you put the chair of the PCC together with an economist who knows a little bit about economic development policy, together with our joint boss, Dr. Ravago. So we'll see. So what I'm going to try to talk about is the role of government in economic growth and development, and then from that to see what that implies for competition and competition policy. So I need to be a two-handed economist, you know, just like what Truman was asking for. So one slide on growth theory. Started from the days when economics was a dismal science. And according to Malthus and Ricardo, as you add labor to a fixed resource base, you go to a stationary state. Whereas Hume would say life is nasty, brutish, and short. Solo was a little more optimistic, but still there was diminishing returns in his growth theory. So you can grow for a while by adding capital faster than labor grows, but eventually the growth rate slows to a steady state, which is equal to technological change. So you've heard about from Hal Ambition 2040, and this coincides with the new growth theory, which is called endogenous growth theory. A lot of people thought Romer should have got the Nobel Prize for that, but it wasn't quite sexy enough, I guess. So in this view, because of externalities associated with human capital, knowledge spillovers, and specialization, which we'll talk about, the growth rate need not slow, which was consistent with the vision of 7% growth in the Philippines. But what's that doing in there? Arcee has already told you about economic development and structural transformation. We have an initial stage of agriculture development where specialization and capital, a little bit of capital accumulation, barely keeps up with diminishing returns. As industrialization becomes the engine of growth, then we get more opportunity for produced plant equipment, human capital, knowledge capital, and increased specialization to increase growth. And finally, the service sector should indeed grow faster than industry and agriculture, but a particular part of the service sector known as the transaction sector. So productivity growth, as was mentioned earlier, comes both from productivity growth within each sector and shifting resources towards higher productivity sectors. And specialization we see as the engine of growth, and the key point there is that as communication costs fall, transportation costs fall, those unit transaction costs fall, it actually facilitates more and more transactions and more complex economic organization and more specialization. go to Lock, Stock, and Barrel. So, think of the first rifle ever made. It was made by a blacksmith who did everything. He made this, the lock, stock, and barrel, and put them together. But later there was horizontal specialization. So different makers of the lock, stock, and barrel. But the components had to be standardized. So I always think of the movie Good, Bad, and the Ugly with Clint Eastwood. And if you've ever seen that movie, Tuco, there's a scene in which Tuco puts together a gun from several different models to get the best gun he can. And the point there is they have to be interchangeable. But later on, as the market grows, you get specialized producers for dedicated components for Remington rifles and dedicated components for Winchester and the other makers. So that requires vertical, so getting horizontal specialization, which then later requires vertical coordination, and that's adding value, both by catering to diverse preferences and by more and more specialization, getting these Marshallian economies of scale, or just Marshallian economies, I should say. So, economic organization is very complex, and you can see right away that having kind of set standards of how competition policy contributes could be a problem. I'm looking at something else. Very interesting. So this is the story of Toyota, just a stylized story, again, illustrating the complexity. So Toyota had one supplier for, unlike the US case, which tends to go for multiple suppliers, Toyota went for one supplier of steering wheels for Camry, another for Cressida. Each was a monopolistic supplier to a particular brand, but competition across models. So Toyota was able to get the best of both worlds. Single sourcing provides relationship to gradually improve quality, but at the same time have the discipline of competition. So again, you see how it's a little bit complicated. And let's go to why economists and others thought competition was a good idea in the first place. It really goes back to Adam Smith, that private interests are guided as if by an invisible hand to an efficient outcome. Of course, that has some assumptions to make that true, which were also mentioned earlier today. So what's the role of government in that view? Well, one is to provide an infrastructure of cooperation such that bilateral contracts in a competitive environment attain efficiency. Then we add to that the original kind of justice, equality under the law, and Adam Smith added public works and institutions. So actually the competition policy would actually go in the first one of those, because it's under the government function of standards and measures to make the market work, really that infrastructure of making bilateral cooperation work. And then we also need a mechanism for multilateral contracts to work. So if you know one graph in economics, This is the one I recommend. So it has both the invisible hand and market failure and the reason for competition policy. So in economics, the only thing you have to know is the Nike rule of economics. Just do it until marginal benefit equals the marginal cost. So that leads to demand curve given by marginal benefit and a supply curve given by marginal cost. And the competitive equilibrium is where those two intersect, and that's also the point that maximizes social benefits. However, the marginal benefit to a monopolist is marginal revenue. How much revenue is added, even though you're raising the price, but if you produce one more unit, you're lowering the price on all previous units, so marginal revenue goes down faster, and so that QM there is the equilibrium for the monopolist, and the red area is the deadweight loss. So if you look at this, you say, the more competition, the better. That's not quite true, always, because if you had two industries, and one were more monopolistic than the other, and you made the less monopolistic one even more competitive, that would make the overall efficiency worse. So we have to be careful about piecemeal, let's just make this particular sector more competitive. Now, the overall objective of government is articulated in the Philippine Constitution, promote the common good, and also later says promote the general welfare. So I suggest we view competition policy as an instrument, not competition as a goal. And what's gone before suggests that if the competition authority plays not just a passive role by responding to complaints and giving approvals when approvals are needed, but also reviews the different sectors and find out where the distortions are the greatest, then this active role can help get the balance we're looking for. There's another suggestion in the literature, especially by Danny Roderick, who's a famous development economist at Harvard, that we should think about dynamics, not static gains like the deadweight loss triangle we just saw, because deadweight loss triangles are tiny relative to the dynamic gains we could get from improving innovation and productivity. That's not quite right again, because if you look at multiple markets at a time, it's not just the distortion in one market you care about, but how that distortion exacerbates problems in another sector. And that exacerbation effect can be 10 times the original deadweight loss. And this is the second best that Chair Bali Sagan was talking about. He also mentioned coordinating investments. If we say dynamic competition literally, that would kind of suggest coordinate investments by futures markets, but those are far too costly. We could also do selective incentives for investment in particular sectors, but that's what John Power, who worked with Jerry Seacott and Bautista, called band-aid economics. The trouble is you leave the old distortions there and just try to patch on, patch up, with new incentives. Of course, that's susceptible to lobbying. The other kind of model is the Keiretsu-Chaibo Japan-Korea model, where you do direct coordination and have the government and various pieces of the private sector cooperate in a particular investment plan. The other one mentioned this morning was economic zones. Korea also does something along the lines of standards and measures, which is quality rating that helps their export sector. I think we're a little slow, so I'll just go on to this. I want to turn to innovation. So how does innovation increase welfare via economic growth? Well, there's cost reductions, but there's also product variety and quality improvements. What's the role of competition in that? Well, this is kind of ironic, but dynamic competition, according to Schumpeter, is really the fight, the competitive fight, to be not competitive. So that's your incentive, is to try to get some profits beyond normal, what we call normal profits, just a return to capital. So the competition that really matters, according to Schumpeter, is competition to develop new technologies, products, organizational forms, and find new sources of supply. And the drivers, so that's the incentive, the quest for monopoly power, and the entry and exit is the mechanism for selection, selecting the best companies, and that's what he called creative destruction. So I won't go into the details of this, but this is a standard textbook argument that the good thing about monopoly is they have all this retained earnings they can use for R&D and shift the marginal cost curve down. So it's possible that that producer gain is greater, the purple, is greater than the green consumer loss, which raises an interesting question. What would you do? So if you care about general welfare, just aggregate welfare, you would say that's good. But I think that's one way that competition authorities differ. Australia, I get the feeling from what was just said, Europe, a little more focus on consumers. Which makes sense. Again, going all the way back to Adam Smith, people of the same trade seldom meet together, even for merriment or diversion, but the conversation ends in a conspiracy against the public or in some contrivance to raise prices. Or as Nobel laureate Ken Arrow put it, it's not the presence of bargaining costs, but that they're biased. So it's easy for producers to get together. It's not easy for consumers to get together or taxpayers and block what the producers are trying to do, for example, by a boycott. So that might be a rationale. Well, we should actually focus on consumers because producers are taking care of themselves. Empirically, it's not true that more competition always produces more innovation. It's true up to a point, and then if you get too much competition, the measure of innovation actually goes down. So where is that sweet point? So what monopolists love to do is to keep out entrants. And that's why the focus might, I see you. Was that a 10? Okay, thank you. So they can do these kind of abuses to resist entrance instead of focusing on innovation and try to maintain their monopoly position through the support of government. So I always think of Minister of Trade and Industry back in the Arroyo administration, Concepcion. So he said, okay, we have our cement policy is one cement producer in the north, one cement producer in the south, and I'll be the one to choose. So you can see how government can be, is needed sometimes to maintain the monopoly position. So lessons, first, do no harm. So for example, if you outlaw shipping, like the Philippines used to do, then you're creating the problem. Maybe develop systems of diagnosing rules and behavior that restrict entry. I think we'll hear more about that in a few minutes. And this is another interesting one, kind of a ideological debate within economics. Question is whether if you have liberalized trade and then you're exposed to the international market, does that mean that domestic or competition policy generally within the country is less important? And there's been some empirical investigation showing that Friedman's claim that trade can substitute found no significant relationship, but that's not a surprise because as in many cases of economics, there's pros and cons. So in the cement example, you can see how liberalizing trade would increase demand for cement and then exacerbate that distortion. So our deadweight loss triangle is going to go up and that's going to exacerbate problems in other industries. So it could go either way. It could be a substitute, it could be a complement. We can't really decide a priori, so we have to investigate. Seem to be able to agree on territory somehow. It's been suggested that evolution within Europe was more focused on macroeconomic issues of price stability and employment. We already mentioned that it seems like the EU is a little more focused on consumer and worker welfare, whereas the US a little more on the total efficiency. So you can't read that, but the only point is that you can look at a timeline in Asia going from the first example of competition policy, I guess that worked, was in Japan in post-war Japan under MacArthur, General MacArthur, and goes all the way to Philippines at the other end, but it's still going, of course. And this just shows the rapid growth since 1990 of competition law and competition authorities. Dreamt up these regressions, and to sort of expose Palem's study to more recent data and also add additional variables. So you see there, the variables of interest include GDP, per capita, trade openness, economic and political change, and possibly the existence of this informal international competition network. And let's just go on. Can't see that either, but it's just a nice example of how Palem found that the only independent variable that really came out was as significant was GDP per capita, but it may be a case of spurious correlation when you add other variables, the neighborhood effect of your what your neighborhood countries are doing and the size of the trade sector, then the importance of GDP per capita diminishes, although when you put everything together, it comes out at a lower level of importance, but still significant. So, I don't know if we'll be able to do it in this paper, but I want to talk just briefly about how new institutional economics works and how it might be applied in competition policy. So, new institutional economics is 40 years old, so it's not really new anymore. So, for example, you first look for contrast. So, looking across countries, are some competition authorities focused on consumers, workers, or general? What about structural differences? Are they independent or are they under another department? What about the scope? So active versus passive, we talked about. Are they going emphasizing more behaviors or organizational form? Are there differences in the process, how they do investigation, how they do adjudication? In some cases, of course, adjudication is not within the competition authority, but passed on to the general court system, sometimes specialized part of the court system. So, the next thing you would look for is correlations. So, among the countries that have a high percentage of their government budget devoted to the competition authority, would that be related to something, another variable characterizing the country, such as GDP per capita? Would some of those differences be explained or be correlated with cultural similarities, like Malaysian, Indonesian, Philippine languages are similar? Does that make a difference? Or does the religious composition make a difference? So we're looking for correlations, and then lastly, you try to get an explanation. So is it in fact driven by a rational response to country differences, and can we suggest a theory of institutional change or institutional differences leading to ability to improve institutional design and tailor it to the characteristics of different countries?